Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Muggle with a Mic. Katie here with a quick little intro. Just to let you guys know we haven't put out a lot of episodes as of late. It gets busy in the summertime, but we are still continuing to get episodes out. Sometimes it takes a little while for Phil and I to organize our recordings and stuff like that, and also organize what movies we're going to talk about and all that stuff. Just remember, everything you see on here, I'm organizing these episodes, I'm doing the graphics, I'm preparing what we're going to talk about, I'm preparing games. It's a lot of stuff that goes into it. So sometimes you get a little bit run out, burnt out a little bit, but I still love doing this podcast. It's just sometimes there might be a gap in between the episodes, a little bit longer sometimes. So we're doing Acolyte today. Hopefully we'll have some movies planned, episodes planned for in the future. But yeah, just have patience sometimes with me. Working hard to get these episodes out, and sometimes it just takes a little bit longer. So thanks for joining us for this episode. Let's get into Star Wars talk.
Right.
Yeah. Of course, the one time we wear Hawaiian shirts, and Chris doesn't wear a Hawaiian shirt.
That's amazing.
I can go change real quick.
Can everyone hear okay? We'll do the technical stuff first.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, good. I can hear fine.
Okay. And I just want to make sure I tested the...
I tested this with Robbie.
Chris. Whoa. I love that we got to see Chris's reaction to it.
And I recorded it too.
That's my dark side voice.
Yeah.
And then my Basil voice is
like this.
Yeah, that tracks.
Welcome everyone back to another episode of Muggle with a Mic. Katie here for another Star Wars episode, and I'm joined by Chris and Robbie. Hey guys.
Hey,
how's it going?
Like the finger guns. We're here again. Of course, we've got you guys. We don't have Phil. He wanted to join us, but we're going to talk about Star Wars Acolyte. But is it like Ohio State where we have to say the Acolyte? Good
question. I think it is, because it is. How it looks in the title. You know, see the Acolyte.
You have to emphasize the as
the.
Well.
Yeah, right. It's not the Acolyte.
Right.
Well, because technically, I mean, we'll just go into it. It's two people, but it's one person. So it should be the Acolytes, or is the Acolyte correct?
Mm. Oh, now we're getting deep.
Oh my. But before we get into it, let's go through our mugs. Let's go with Robbie. Robbie's up top, so we'll have him go first.
All right. So I was telling Katie, when I first joined, I recently went to California, and one of the things that I wanted to do while I was out there is go to Rancho Obi-Wan.
Oh.
So if for anyone that doesn't know, Rancho Obi-Wan is a Star Wars personal collection from a guy named Steve Sansweet. He worked for Lucasfilm for years, and then he started his own like kind of personal collection. Mm-hmm. And it's like the largest, I think Guinness recognizes it as the largest personal Star Wars collection like in the world. So that was something really cool experience to do, get out there and do that. And it was like the highlight of my trip when we were out there. So I came home with that little memorabilia mug, as you can see. So
that's fantastic.
Yeah. And by the way, Chris, somehow Ann Newman was our like docent. She led the tour. And your name came up because we were talking about their art gallery, and she said to send their regards to you. I think she had mentioned you had maybe done some work for him.
Yeah.
In the past. So yeah.
I've done a few projects for him. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool stuff.
Yeah. That's great. Anne is like kind of responsible for me getting Mark Hamill's autograph.
Oh, wow.
It's a crazy story.
Wow. But
she helped me get his autograph one time, and I'm forever grateful to her.
Yes, you're forever indebted, I bet. Yeah. that's amazing.
Yeah.
6 degrees of separation.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
That's super neat. Well, we're not going to live up to that mug.
No.
Good luck, Chris. No.
Okay. my mug, this is like a cool little thing. This is like a really old plastic tiny mug from 1983. Mm-hmm. That's got some of the promotional key art from Return of the Jedi on it, but it's just plastic little dinky thing that kids would use. Well, last year on the Shop Disney website, they've got a lot of Star Wars exclusive stuff. They for Return of the Jedi's 40th anniversary, they came out with a ceramic version that's bigger. And when I saw that, I'm like, I gotta have that. It's like an homage to the old one. So I went ahead and picked that one up.
Yeah, how many people do you think have both?
I don't know.
Probably not too many.
But there's just something about these like very basic drawings of the characters from that time that like I was like blasted with those images when I was a kid. So I love them.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Neato. So and one might break, but you'll still have the other one.
Right. I had to get that mug when I saw it.
Yes. Very cool.
Super neat. Mine isn't Star Wars related, guys.
It's okay.
Boo. No, I'm kidding.
You're already booing it before you see it. It is pretty cool. Okay. It's a Back to the Future mug.
Oh.
Back to the Future 2, but check out the handle. It's a hoverboard.
That's awesome.
That's a great one.
You kept it in the genre, sci-fi. So it's still very fitting. Yeah.
Counts. And if Loki's involved, time variance, it could all just match together. Doom, Robert Downey Jr. and all that stuff now?
Oh, that's crazy, isn't it?
It's wild.
I haven't watched the latest season of Loki, so I don't know how this is going to work. And
yeah,
I haven't either. I watched and enjoyed the first season, but have yet to watch the second.
Yeah, the second season's really good as well. And it's got like one of the best endings to any Marvel thing. I feel it's really good.
Now I have to stop watching baseball and watch the second season of Loki.
Right. Yeah.
Yep. All right. So great mugs. They were all great. I honestly can't compare them. We had one awesome one from Robbie with a great story. We had a twinning like May and Osho with Chris's. And then we had my oddball one.
I liked the Back to the Future one. It was good.
Yeah.
They were all great. Mugs. Yeah.
That's my favorite one. By the way, real quick, which is your favorite Back to the Future? 1, 2, or 3?
I think for me, 2 barely edges out the rest. Barely. I really like the first one. I enjoy the third one, but it's my least favorite. But I think 2 barely edges out the first one for me.
Yeah.
How shameful would it be if I would say that I have not seen all 3?
Only extremely.
Let me turn off Bobby's mic for the remainder of the episode.
It was nice talking to you.
Cut him off.
No, yeah, that's been one of the. So I have like a list of like at least 50 movies, probably more. It's on the list. It's just it hasn't happened yet. But right. I want to go back and I'll probably just rewatch the whole trilogy because I think I've seen the first one. And then like parts of the second one, I've never seen any of the third. So it's on the list to go back and watch those, but maybe I'll get there this fall, hopefully. So
yeah.
The second one for me is by far the best. Then it's 1, of course. And 3 is the third one. It's good. It's just not as great as the other two.
Right. Right. No. I agree.
All right, guys. So we talked before, and we're going to do the quiz first to kind of get it into talking about the Acolyte. And we can talk as we're doing it, and that'll get us into conversation and all that stuff. So let me transition to the game screen. Uno momento. Sensor Wars, episode... What are we on now?
Episode question mark.
Yeah. I feel like it might be episode 6 or 7.
we've got a whole saga going on.
Yeah, I'll fix it in post. I'll figure out what it actually is.
Okay.
But okay. So, who? Well, it's not going to be who goes first. I'm just going to play the clip, and then you guys are buzzing in. Do you have your buzzers at the ready, sirs?
Yes.
Do we buzz in just as soon as we think we know? Do we wait till the...
Buzz in as soon as you know, but I'm going to play the whole clip.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I reset the buzzers. And so we have 12.
Okay.
Okay. I have this set up with my Rodecaster. I think I got it all prepared. Okay.
Quick question.
Yeah.
How many times have you seen the episodes, Chris?
I think I've seen all of them at least twice.
You're going to school me.
Oh, no. The fact that you have to think about it.
Yeah. I don't know. My memory's awful these days. So
I've seen like episode 1, 5, and 8 twice. And then everything else I didn't rewatch. So okay.
All right.
You're going to kill me.
Well, I don't know.
I will say this series is like Andor, where I think you appreciate it more the second go around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've found that, like, now that they've laid everything out, you just go back and you're like, oh yeah, look at that. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, it's like a lot of stuff kind of signaling what's gonna happen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So,
yeah,
foreshadowing.
Yeah.
All right, number one, buzzers at the ready, and away we go.
The Force is powerful, like fire or the ocean. It is a power we must.
I have no idea.
Gosh.
Roberto.
I'll just take a wild guess and say obey. I don't know.
I think. There we go. Oh, Christopher.
I will go. Respect?
Let's see.
It is a power we must respect.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Good guess.
That was just a guess.
That might be what all these are.
Yeah.
All right. So Chris has one. Here is the second. I'm resetting the buzzers. Here's the second clip.
Your training was difficult, to say the least. Attachments to those we have lost are the most difficult to let go.
So why are you here? Last night, a Jedi was murdered on... Who?
Master Andara.
The suspect matched your description.
This one is difficult.
We're looking for a planet name, I suppose. Mm-hmm.
Yep. And I think we're only on that planet the first couple episodes, right?
Yeah.
I think. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Is it Brendok? Yeah, I think that's a planet name in the show, but
it is.
That's the only one I can remember.
Me too.
They say that one a lot.
Yeah.
Brendok.
Man. I don't even have, I can't even buzz in to guess. Everything I could guess, I know would be wrong. So.
I will say I realized I didn't have another one from episode 1, so I went in to find this one. I was like, this one's going to be really difficult.
That's a tough one.
I knew I was being mean on this one.
You schooled us both.
Yeah, I wouldn't have gotten it. I only
point
know
for Katie.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the only way I could score against you guys. All right, here's the answer.
Last night, a Jedi was murdered on Ueda.
Ueda.
Oh, boy.
You ain't getting this answer right.
You ain't getting this answer, yeah.
Okay, clip number 3.
Stationed on 16 years ago. Indara, Torben, Kelnaka, and you. She wants to kill you.
It's a long clip. Sorry, guys.
No, you're good.
Yeah, Robbie. Robbie buzzed in.
I'm going to say Brindock.
Yeah.
She wants to kill 4 Jedi stationed on Brindock 16 years ago.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right.
Back on track. I had to get you, Chris, because I knew that's going to be one of the few that I know, so I hit buzz immediately. Yeah.
Isn't it funny that you said Brendok right before this one? So
right.
Fresh in your mind.
Right.
All right. Clip number 4.
Don't be afraid, Oshi.
Action is about walking through fear. It is about sacrificing a part of yourself. The power of many instead of the power of one.
I was going to try to buzz, but I can't buzz. I don't have it.
It's I reset it. I apologize. Oh, Robbie buzzed in.
I'm going to say the thread. But it's okay. I was going to say that's a guess.
Man, can I hear it again?
Yeah. We're on 4. Yeah.
Don't be afraid, Oshi.
Action is about walking through fear. It is about sacrificing a part of yourself. The power of many instead of the power of one.
It's the something they're referring to their ritual. Mm-hmm. But I can't think of what it would be. I can't think of what it would, what she's saying.
Yeah, they said it multiple times, but like if I hadn't been watching the series knowing I'd do a censor war, I was trying to oh, that's a word they keep saying. So yeah. I'm paying attention just to words.
Is it okay? I'm gonna okay. Is it the ascension?
Ascension is about
nice.
All right.
Good job.
As soon as you said it. There. Yep, that's it.
I'm going to give you 2 points, sir.
I could not have thought of that for the life of me, though.
Okay, so discussion on that part. Like, just in that clip alone, they don't sound like a bad group of people. They're making the whole opposite point of the of what I feel like the Jedi try to say they do, but I don't think they do. Mm-hmm. But they're all about the betterment of the whole group of people rather than just an individual.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, they never came off as evil to me, except for when they are defending their own home, which I'd probably be kind of evil too. So,
yeah, yeah,
not evil, just tough.
Just tough. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
They used the tools that they had.
Yeah.
So.
But the fact that they did that magic to make 2 people. I mean, I want to hear more about that. I feel like we didn't get enough information on that.
We didn't. Yeah, right. We got. Yeah. But now they were training the girls with like. Kind of dark. I mean, their teachings have a dark side flavor to them. Like they're not. Their tone, I guess, like they're when Mother Anasea is training and giving their lessons, I mean, she basically attacks them, like, and causes them to like defend themselves and stuff. That's not typically how the Jedi would train. That's more like in line with how like a dark side or a Sith user would train.
Mm-hmm.
But, and I'm cool with it.
Yeah.
I mean, they're like gray Jedi in a way, because I don't know. I like the dark side. It's appealing. All right. Let's go on to clip number 5.
Where am I?
We are on our way to Coruscant.
What happened?
They started a f- It destroyed everything. You can't.
Yeah, Robbie.
Fire.
They started a fire.
See, I gave you an easy. I gave you guys an easy one.
That's the only ones I'll be able to get.
Mate, and I even the way I edited it, you can hear right before you said fire.
If there's one thing I know about the show, it's that May started a fire.
Yeah. We only heard that, I think, once per episode at least.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. And what did she expect? I mean, she's burning that book and then she just drops it to the ground. Mm-hmm. But May was, I don't know. I don't know how I like that. May started out annoying and OSHA was good, and then it completely flipped. At the, in the very, very end of it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think, didn't I message you that after we watched the first two episodes? I think I sent you a message saying, I think they're going to flip roles by the end of the show. So I was kind of prepared for that.
Yeah.
Predictable, you think?
Maybe a little bit, just because they were kind of already after the two episodes, I thought they were kind of playing into the duality of them.
Yeah.
And I could kind of see that. I think in that second episode, they like exchange looks when May's in the speeder, OSHA's standing there with the blaster. And like May almost had a compassionate look and OSHA kind of looked angry. And I was like, they're going to flip by the time this is over. That's kind of what made me think that. So,
yeah, I didn't get that until like the end of episode 5, where they kind of go off with their different masters.
Right.
Sort of. I'm like, oh, I think I know what's going on here.
Yep. Yep.
I don't know. Phil and I talked about it when we did our last episode. And I am kind of tired of the twin story. Mm-hmm. But that's a thread in Star Wars that I don't think you can clip. It's a thing that's continues throughout every story. Like, I don't know. I think it's almost like now every story has to have it, because it's a connection between every story. I don't know.
Huh. Yeah.
But this was different because I told you, Robbie, I thought they were two people with one mind.
Yes.
Like a galactical schizophrenia.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I thought, well, maybe that's what's going on here. And then I kept watching like the episodes and I'm like, I don't think that would work. I don't think one is like projecting another because
right.
How they interact with the other characters. It didn't kind of make sense.
Right.
So, yeah.
I mean, it's interesting. It's an interesting story. That's for sure. Mm-hmm. All right. Number 6.
Saul thinks that May can be saved.
Master Saul is a wise Jedi. You must have reason to suspect May will listen to what you have to say.
But if it comes to it, and she doesn't listen to me, you need to stop her. I won't be able to do it.
OSHA.
Please. I can't hesitate a second time.
I've known you since we were younglings. May has always been your wound. Maybe Saul brought you here to face her. But maybe he brought you here to face your. We need to catch up.
Oh, my phone's off. I went to sleep. Who could it be? Who could have buzzed in? Chris!
Just a guess. She says yourself? Or he says yourself.
Maybe Saul brought you here to face her. But maybe he brought you here to face yourself.
Good job.
I would have said your past, so I was wrong.
It would have been a good guess. Now that's the thing is, I guess the thing that makes it interesting is they didn't turn opposite until OSHA found out that it was Saul and the Jedi who basically are responsible for her family's death, not May. I think her whole life she was thinking it was May. Mm-hmm. And then when she found that out, she's flipping to the dark side. But May has known all her life. So she's coming to understand it more, I guess. And yeah. OSHA hasn't had that time.
Right, right. Yeah, a lot of people think, I've seen a lot of people say that she like dropped her assassin plan awfully quick. Whenever she like tied up her master, like he's swinging from a tree and everything. And she's like, forget this, I'm out. I think that a lot of people say it was like a quick transition, but I don't think so. Cause she never knew her sister was alive until like a few hours before.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that I would drop everything to pursue her, like getting back in touch with her. Cause she thought she was dead this whole time. So I would probably not try to kill Jedi masters because I might not succeed. I would try to reunite with my sister.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Vengeance is number two on the list now.
Yeah. Right.
Out. Yeah. No. Except unless you're Maul.
Sure.
Then it's always vengeance.
Yeah. It's what you do.
Yeah.
All right. Number seven.
What is that?
Identify yourself. Stand down.
I'm sorry. I love the sound in that scene.
Yes, it's incredible.
So that's why I played the whole clip, because you feel it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Definitely.
Chris, Robbie, we couldn't even hear the buzz in because of the lightsaber sound. Go ahead, Chris.
I think it's run. He says run.
Watch out! Run!
Good job. Oh, he had a good panicked voice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. I mean, there's nothing like the sound of a lightsaber being turned on. And then that vibrating sound. And mm-hmm. If you hear a clip of it and you don't know what it is, you know what it is.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
All right. Number eight.
What are you?
I have no name. But a Jedi like you might call me Sith.
Oh.
Why risk discovery?
Well,
I wonder if
you faked me out.
What do you want?
To wield my power the way I like, without having to answer to Jedi like you.
Robbie buzzed in first.
I thought I knew where the buzz was coming, or the beep was coming, and I was totally wrong.
You thought it was Sith, didn't you?
Yeah. Oh, boy. Oh boy. Can I hear, is it possible to hear it again?
Yeah, it will. If it's okay, I'll play the whole clip.
Okay. Yeah.
Why risk discovery?
Well, I did wear a mask.
What do you want?
To wield my power the way I like, without having to answer to Jedi like you.
Oh. Freedom?
What do you want?
Freedom.
Woo.
Good one.
I almost botched that one, but I saved it.
You did. By this, what's the skin of your chinny chin chin? That's not
the skin of your teeth. Yeah.
Okay, what do we think about Manny's characters? Our character. At the end of what is it, episode 5 or episode 4, when he does his little force wielding and everything, I was impressed. Mm. And then I felt a little left down the rest of the season.
Hmm. In what way? Like, just based off of, because I thought in the finale, especially, he kind of felt sidelined by the whole twin thing.
Exactly. I thought we'd get more into his character, and really, he was just used as a vehicle to tell more of May's story.
Yeah, because from episodes like 5 to maybe 7, I thought he was like carrying the series, like on his back. I thought he was a strong point, and then I did think he felt a little sidelined. Although his fight with Saul in the finale was incredible. That was top-notch stuff. But it kind of felt like they didn't know what to do with him at times, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
It just felt a little messy with him at times, like given the relationship with the twins, especially when May Osha and Chimere were kind of united at the end there. It all just felt jumbled to me.
What do you think, Chris?
Well, I liked his character the further the show went along. Like, I kind of figured out, like, when he was the bumbling goof early on, I'm like, they're not going to make him the master, are they? They're not going to do that. I was like, come on, that's no good. And then he shows up. I'm like, I was wrong. I think this works. This is funny. I mean, that's what they would do. I mean, they would hide out in the open like that and not let on who they are. But no, I mean, I thought it was great. And I thought him playing the goofy character and then like the incredibly dark, like mysterious guy, I thought that was pretty cool. And I mean, yeah, he was kind of sidelined, but I think like there's a lot to explore with that character still.
Right.
And I do feel like they're going to get a second season, but like just how he ended up with May to begin with.
Yeah.
I mean, we have no idea.
Yeah.
They never go into that. So I don't know, but I thought the lightsaber duels were incredible. I don't know. Just hadn't seen like that episode 5 where he's just making short work of everybody. It's like, I hadn't really seen that in a long time.
Yeah.
And I thought it was really, really cool, but no, I'm really interested in the character. I'm just, I think that there's more room to grow with what they want to tell.
Mm-hmm. No, at the end of that episode, when he just force pushes everyone and then it goes to black, I sat there stunned for a while.
Yeah.
Like I was alone and I went, I think I paused it and I looked around as if I was talking to the crowd in the room. What happened?
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. My son didn't like, he didn't care for that quick cut. It's like, you got to be kidding me.
Yeah.
I loved it because it got a reaction out of, like, I was talking out loud to the empty room.
Yeah, yeah.
The anticipation that built into the next episode too was good.
The next episode delivered too, so it's not like it was wasted.
Right. Because I think that was episode 4 where that cut happens?
It was 5, I think.
So
yeah, I feel like it was 5, yeah.
That's when the big fight is, right?
Or maybe, no, you're right. Yeah, I think 5 is the big fight and 4 is where the cut happens.
Okay, I was going to say, because I thought that necessarily episode 4 wasn't the strongest episode. So if episode 5 hadn't delivered, then that could have been looked at in a different light. But I think since it did bring in the action, it was acceptable.
Yeah.
No, yeah. Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah, episode 4 was titled Day, and that was them with Basil hunting, you know, tracking. And then at the end they find him, and then episode 5 is Night, and it's the whole night of them, you know, running from him and or trying to run from him, but
Yeah.
They did good. Yeah, I those two episodes were very interesting. Mm-hmm. Oh, guys, we're playing a game. Let's go. This is why I thought doing this and then it would get us talking.
Absolutely.
Okay. The score is 4-3. Chris is in the lead. All right. Clip number 9.
But there is another way. Below the surface of consciousness are powerful emotions. Anger, fear, loss, desire.
That's the path to the dark side.
This was a hard one.
Yeah, it was really hard.
Did he curse at her?
No, he didn't.
Oh, I think. Oh, yeah.
Oh. My phone went to sleep, but I'm assuming that's Chris.
That's Chris.
I think he says semantics.
Mm.
That's the path to the dark side.
Semantics.
Very good, Chris.
That's a good one, yeah.
Yeah, I didn't think anyone would get that. I thought I'd stump you on that one.
Mm-hmm. That was a tough one.
Okay, how do we feel about the super chill helmet? It's basically like when you go into a pool that's completely dark and you don't know about gravity. That's what that helmet, I feel like it does.
Yeah. Yeah. That's crazy. When she put it on and we see the continuation of it in the beginning of the next episode and things start going crazy, it's like, wow, this is really cool. 'Cause it's like, and I heard it like in the comics, they've kind of touched on Sith helmets having like their own abilities and stuff. And I haven't read hardly any comics, but no, I think it was cool that they kind of made it more than just a helmet, you know?
Mm-hmm. That helmet was made out of cortosis, right? So that was cool for them to bring that element into the story, and I know that cortosis has existed in like for a long time, and I don't think it was ever canonized until the series. It was in Legends, I know, pretty heavily. So the like cortosis, and now like you got Beskar, like there are certain metals or elements that can kind of combat lightsabers, so it's kind of cool to see the cortosis thing brought in, and how it affects the Jedi's blades when it, you know, when it touches. So that was pretty cool. I did enjoy that part.
So is it what's causing like the sensory deprivation, or is it some other thing that's causing that?
I think it was supposed to have been the cortosis, but I don't know that that was ever a story element in Legends. They may have kind of introduced that in the Acolyte.
Yeah, that's what I gather as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we all learn that together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey.
Mm-hmm.
Neato. Didn't know it was called cortosis. Is it from a planet called Cortosa?
I don't know where it originated. Someone said, and I don't know if this is true, but someone said you could see like that cave maybe was like a cortosis mine, maybe, and that's where he got the cortosis from. I don't know if that's true. I need to go back and rewatch some of those episodes.
Yeah, like when Osha and Chimer are in his like little cave hideout thing, they like focus on the wall a little bit. And the first time through, I'm like, what am I looking at? Why are they showing that to us? But then you can see like the rocks are like discolored in one section, and it's kind of the same color as his helmet.
Yeah. And I didn't even realize that.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, I missed that too. I read it online later, but I didn't. Yeah, I couldn't remember the specifics. So.
Yeah, and I remember from, I was thinking it was the original Thrawn trilogy that they bring up Cortosis for the first time. I could be wrong about that. But whenever I saw the blades getting deactivated, I was so happy that I knew exactly why that was happening. I'm like, oh, he's got Cortosis all over him. This is nuts that they're doing that. So I'm so glad I wasn't stumped. Like, how's that happening?
Right.
My geekness paid off, and I was able to pinpoint it immediately.
You passed the quiz. Yeah. So help me out, though. We've never seen that used in the recent stuff. So do you think maybe like Jedi outlawed it or it got used up? Why haven't we seen it? I mean, this is 100 years before episode one, right?
Yeah. No, I heard like through fan chatter and stuff in books and stuff, that's incredibly rare. And it's also not very strong material. Like it can, so it's like not the easiest thing to get a hold of. And I think there's a book where Jedi do kind of outlaw it or something.
Okay.
I'm not sure. I'd have to look into it, but there seems like something like that going on.
Interesting. This is why I have you guys on. Cause I missed all that. I guess I didn't. Help me out. Where were the places where it was affecting the blades? Where it was.
That was in their big fight in episode 5 when Chimera first shows up with his helmet on.
Okay.
He has like a gauntlet on his wrist, I think. And then he also, his helmet, he's like, he headbutts, like he takes a lightsaber head on, like headbutts and it deactivates.
Okay. Now that you say that, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's momentarily like the lightsabers, they come back into effect within a couple seconds after. But yeah, it's almost like a short circuits and temporarily.
Right.
Yeah. And that really cool fight scene with Jeki and Chimera where she shows off right before she meets her demise. I forget exactly how, but she ends up with two blades because at one point one gets deactivated by Chimera's Cortosis. And then she has two. She's fighting with two there for a bit. And then, Yeah. And she kind of like looks at him because the other one activates. And she's like, gotcha now. And then, you know, they take off fighting. So that was a cool element to add in.
Well, since we're talking about lightsabers, the last episode when it changes from blue to red, thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, it had been established. So I thought it was really cool to see. It's like when you, like the official description is when you like are like really angry and you're letting all your negative emotions go through you. If you're like near a crystal or touching a crystal, it just turns it red because that's not their natural state and it kind of corrupts it. So
I think they were, I actually appreciated that they did this because they made a note to make sure that the lightsaber was damaged and like the crystal was exposed. And I think that does play a part in how those are like, I think that was brought to light in what, the Ahsoka novel? Is that when really all that became canonized? I know George Lucas was even considering doing that with Anakin's back in Revenge of the Sith. But you would have the big problem of when Obi-Wan gives Luke the lightsaber and A New Hope, it's blue, right?
Yeah. So,
but I know, I want to say that a big part of the bleeding the crystal has to be that the Kyber crystal has to be like exposed or like there has to be like that. And like Anakin's was never exposed when he fell to the dark side. So, but where, Saul's lightsaber became damaged and then a dark side user wields that lightsaber and the crystal's kind of out in the open more. Mm-hmm. I think that played a part into why it was able to be bled. Yeah. Which a lot of people were like running with that and saying, oh, like a lot of people were critical of that. And I actually didn't mind that part. I actually thought that was really cool to see.
Yeah.
See that live. So, or brought into like a live action show for the first time. So,
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's been in comics and books, but this is the first live action. I don't think they did it in animation at all. I could be wrong.
I think you're right. Did we see, I feel like there was something funky we saw with, oh no, maybe I'm wrong. I was thinking maybe in one of the Ahsoka like Tales of the Jedi or something. She doesn't, the lightsaber doesn't bleed, but I don't know. There's so much Star Wars stuff. I'm probably mixing up my stories.
Right.
Yeah. I actually think I'm thinking when she kills the Inquisitor with no hand, with her bare hands, maybe.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
But isn't that a great thing that there's so much content you can't get straight?
Man, it used to feel like you were like a Star Wars expert. Like I felt like I would know everything up and down about Star Wars. And now it's just like the amount of content we have, it's so hard to keep up with it all.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Speaking of content, let's go to clip number 10. Here we go. We've got three more to do.
It's unwise to insult a Wookiee's cooking.
I'm just sick of eating Nuna legs. And I want to go home to Coruscant.
I know. But we're on a mission.
We've been here for 7 weeks. And there's no one here. And if we were going to find something, we probably would have found it by now.
100 years ago, this planet was cataloged as lifeless because of disaster. Yet this planet, Brendok, is thriving.
So there's some plants here. Big deal.
Calm yourself, Padawan.
Ooh, who was it? It was Chris.
I'm going to go with hyperspace.
100 years ago, this planet was cataloged as lifeless because of a hyperspace disaster.
Very good.
That's like the one thing I knew about the High Republic era coming into the Acolyte, because I haven't read any of the books, but
yeah, neither have I.
So that's a big reference point, I believe, in that era of the novels, is the big hyperspace disaster
on Brendok.
Yeah, in that system.
Yeah, it affects like a lot of planets, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, and it like shuts down hyperspace lanes, maybe, or I don't really remember. I don't know specifics, but it was a big like.
Is it related to why Elphaba, the Wicked Witch of the West, Jedi, doesn't like to travel hyperspace? Do you think there's a connection?
Oh, Vernestra?
Yeah.
I looked into that. I don't think so. Okay. The reasoning behind that is I read that she gets like super attuned to the Force when she's in hyperspace. So much that it's like overwhelming and she hates traveling that way. So
she has like visions basically, or like just weird forced dreams or whatever. Yeah. I looked that up too, cause I didn't know why they kept referencing that like four times or three or four references. It's like every time this woman's getting on a ship, like someone's like, "You're flying." It's like, what is going on here?
Well, so, also, I watched a video of someone possibly saying that that's connected to, you know, how when they put the helmet on May and she went to that other place and almost went to the dark side, that Elphaba, what's her name?
Vernestra.
That Vernestra, that's what happens when she goes in there, that she's more, vulnerable to the dark side because of it.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Could be.
And those are the visions she's seen. So I don't know. Okay.
She's a jerk.
Oh, you don't like her?
No, I do actually, but she is a jerk. She's like this era's Mace Windu.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. I'd agree with that.
But worse. I'd say worse. Yeah. She's more unlikable.
What color is your lightsaber?
It's got it's like purple. The purple light whip, white, right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Which I was mad that we saw her only use of that in the trailer.
Mm-hmm.
It's like we got a clip of her using that whip in the trailer, and it's like, oh, she's going to have a big, cool fight scene with it. And
yeah. She'll have it once. She used it once.
She smacked a moth off a tree with it or whatever. Right.
Yeah.
Bug zapper.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd be disappointed if I got in a Star Wars series and that's the only thing I did with my weapon.
Right, yeah.
All right, number 11.
It was foolish to come back here, Jedi.
We come with intentions.
You wish to know if we will allow Osha to join you, to be raised by an institution instead of a family.
The twins. Where did they come from?
I like this line.
How were they created?
Someday those intentions you all have will destroy every Jedi in the galaxy.
Robbie.
I'm just going to say good.
Oh, no.
Okay, I know what it is then.
Chris.
Noble.
Noble, yep.
Someday those noble intentions you all have will destroy every Jedi in the galaxy.
Noble. And predicting the future.
Yep.
Holier than thou Jedi. You know, I like few Jedi, but for the most part, it's just like politics. I mean, that's what they're representing in the series. The whole organization is just messed up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. That's one of my gripes with the show is like most of the Jedi, pretty much every Jedi we see in the series, just at one point or another, just acts like a total buffoon.
Like, Yord taking off his shirt. So, I mean, yeah. Why?
It's like I don't. Yeah, I wish we had some contrast so that we know that it's like, yes, we know ultimately what happens to the Jedi, and they don't see their downfall coming, and they let a Sith infiltrate the Galactic Senate, but and become a Chancellor right under their nose. But I feel like we're 100 years removed from that, so we should start to maybe, like, we should at least have contrast. Like, I know they brought in a Yoda cameo at the end and stuff, but every Jedi they focused on in this series was just very flawed and, like, in some ways unlikable. Saul was, I thought, was very strong, but also very flawed. He was very emotional. But he was at least, you could at least see, like, his perspective on a lot of things. But I don't know. I feel like they should have brought in a prototypical Jedi character or, like, somebody to, like, stabilize, like, oh, hey, like,
Balance it out,
yeah, because it was just too much, just buffoonery. I can't think of a better word.
Many flaws in the individuals,
right.
Yeah.
No, I thought Endara was going to be that character, and she was, like, right up until the end of the flashback. She's right. Like, we're going to just cover this up.
Yeah.
I mean, she was the voice of reason up to that point.
She was, yeah, and that's... there was just a lot of character inconsistencies with the Jedi. It's like, you think you know where they're going, and then it's like, they pull the rug out from under you, and they kind of just shift directions.
Yeah.
So I felt that was kind of hard to follow or, like, get behind. Yeah, that was one of my gripes with it. So.
I agree. There was no Jedi you liked.
Right.
I mean,
and like I said, Saul was at least, like, at times you felt like you could root for him, but then it's like, and his acting portrayal, he was a very strong, he had a very strong performance, I thought, yeah. Whereas some other actors, I didn't care for their portrayals, but I thought he acted really well, and you could see the conflict and turmoil in him at times, so. But yeah, you didn't know who to root for on the Jedi side, and then you just had
Saul was a good representation of someone trying to be a Jedi and a human at the same time, and it didn't work. You can't do it. You can't have emotions or anything. Who busted? Robbie.
I think a drop of water.
The next one.
A drop of water landed on my phone. Sorry.
The force. No, but Saul just. I mean, you feel bad for him, but at the same time, he just messed everything up, literally.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And that's why I love when they get back to the ship after the incident that Endara like almost beats him up. I was like, yeah, I'll get him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh no, yeah. Soul, I could talk about Soul for a whole episode.
Yeah.
Cause he's so confusing of a character. You want to like him, but then you're like, dude, you're making it very hard for me to like you.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Which right. makes a good character. I mean, you want to watch that. So
right. Yeah.
No,
that's one thing that I like about the show is like Star Wars started out with very good versus evil. You kind of knew where everybody stood.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's expanded so much. You can kind of get muddy with it and yep. like different motivations. And I think that that's really cool.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Do a lot of exploring that way.
Yeah. It's not just yin and yang. It's everything in between. It's mm-hmm. not just May and Osha. It's everything in between.
Yeah.
All right. Here's the last one. I think this one will be hard. But knowing me, you guys will probably get this like in 2 seconds. Okay, here we go. I love this conversation. It is a long clip, but I love the conversation and the two characters in it.
You don't like me. You think my campaign for an external review of the Jedi is a personal vendetta?
If you want my honest opinion, yes.
Good. Here's mine.
I think the Jedi are a massive system of unchecked power, posing as a religion. A delusional cult that claims to control the uncontrollable.
We don't control the Force.
Not the Force. Your emotions. You project an image of goodness and restraint. But it's only a matter of time before one of you snaps. And when, not if, that happens, who will be strong enough to stop him?
That's certainly an opinion, and not one shared by the rest of the Senate.
The majority of my colleagues can't imagine a galaxy without the Jedi. And I can understand why.
When you're looking up to heroes, you don't have to face what's right in front of you.
Is that all, Senator?
I have reported your lack of transparency to Chancellor. He may invite you to a Senate tribunal for an update. Before you have this suspect in custody.
It's not what you thought, huh?
Oh, man.
I've got nothing.
No. Nope.
I'll take a stab, but it's not gonna be right.
Robbie buzzed in.
it's Chancellor.
I'll give you Hitzner. A clue.
I don't know.
you're not gonna win, but I'll give you a clue. Don't dwell on it too much. Dwell it. Dwell on it.
Okay, now I'm more confused. I said Pixner, but I have no idea. It's just pulling a name. It's like,
is that
it's like a two
galactical Pixar?
I just made something up.
Here we go. Don't dwell on it.
I have reported your lack of transparency to Chancellor Drellick.
Drellick. Dwell it.
Well, now we know three chancellors in Star Wars history.
Yeah.
Dwellick, Valorum, and Palpatine.
Mm-hmm. All right. So Chris won Censor Wars. Congrats, Chris.
Congrats. Thank you. The Force was strong with you.
Someone's really cheering. Yeah.
I didn't know we had such a crowd watching.
It's the crowd that was watching that one episode with me and it was talking to
them. Right.
So any other things with the series that you wanted to go over that we haven't talked about?
I have a question. So what would you guys rate this out of 10? What are your guys' thoughts?
I would go with a 7 out of 10.
Okay. Katie?
It went up and down for me throughout the series. Yeah. So it started out pretty good, went down, and then, you know, episode 4, it went up. And then I got bored, and then it got better at the end. I mean, when they introduced, like, I'll just come out with a name. I'm sorry. I'm going rambling. I'd probably give it a 5.5.
Okay. That, and it sounds like me and you, because I'm at a 5. I think I would rate it a 5.
Okay.
So finish your thought there, because I think we're going to agree.
I think they took too long to tell some of the stories. Spending a whole episode on the background of Osha and May, I think we could have done that in a shorter period of time. But I mean, maybe they gave us information that we'll need later down the road. But right now, I feel like they could have done it more concisely, like 6 episodes rather than 8, with like Obi-Wan.
Right.
Yeah.
That I totally agree. I thought it's the first 2 episodes were solid, and then was 3 the entire flashback episode, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Yes.
So 3 and 7 were our flashback episodes. I felt like they would kind of start to get momentum built, and then I felt like the 2 flashback episodes just derailed everything they were doing. I thought that it was just like, I get that they were trying to show context for this mystery, you know, that we don't know what happened 16 years prior. But I don't know. It just felt choppy, maybe a little rushed. And the flashback episode, specifically episode 7, where we see more so like Soul's retelling of that.
Mm-hmm.
Just the Jedi's.
When he's younger, you mean?
Yeah. Yeah. They're choices were just really dumb. Like they were just like, I felt like it could have been better written. That's all. Like I thought that they could have found better writing. What, like, and it was cool there. That's the thing, for every like one really cool thing that happened, it was immediately contrasted by like just a dumb thing that happened. like it was really cool seeing, yeah, Mother Anasaya get in Jedi Torben's head, right, as the Padawan. It was really cool, mm-hmm, how she, mm-hmm, gets in his head and is like what's the one thing you want, like, but it's like he wants to go home, like that's the best thing you could give me. It's like he's homesick. It's like, I don't know, it's like that's just one specific thing. It's like
kid asking their parent, are we home, are we there yet, are we there,
yeah,
yet?
Yeah. Which I mean, that one isn't even the worst. There's just everything. It's like the combat. I thought the combat was like some of the best, maybe the best lightsaber combat we've seen in the Disney era. Episode 5 was fantastic. And then Soul and Chimera's face off again. That was incredible in the finale. But then they added in, and maybe this was just me, I wasn't a fan of the like Matrix slow-mo stuff that they added.
Yeah.
It gave it a little bit of a cheesiness that is like, I feel like that doesn't maybe belong in Star Wars. That's just my opinion.
And especially with that actor who already has that in another movie.
Right. Yeah. Because then I felt like, and then everyone's calling her Jedi Trinity, and it's like,
well, oh, while we're doing this, I'll bring this out. Look at my fancy little, my binder. And
that's nice.
There is something in this series that looks like this binder.
Yeah.
I don't remember what it was, but I bought this before the series. It's not a Star Wars binder. I got it because it looked kind of like, you know, paneling.
Yeah.
But it's got all my Tops cards in
it. It was like a book or something, right?
Is it a book or something?
I know what you're talking about because I can like see it in my head, but I can't.
I'll look for it on my phone.
I can't remember specifically.
But I got excited because I looked at it and I was like, that's my trading card binder. And I felt as if I predicted the future.
So yep. I missed the beginning. What do you think the binder looks like exactly?
I felt like I saw something in the series and I was like, that's my binder. And it looked like this. It was these colors.
Yeah, there's like a book. I don't know if it's a book, but there's something that maybe a character's carrying at one point, and it's got like some stripes and a diagonal. Like, yeah, it does look a lot like that, but I can't remember. I can't remember who it was or what episode or anything.
Yeah,
the word to describe my feeling when I saw it was I was giddy.
It does look very Star Warsy. The binder does. Yeah.
But here's my latest. I shared with you guys, but we're going to share with the podcasting world all of my cards. There you go.
Uh-huh.
And Chris, I'm just going to say it now. You tell me if I have to take it out, but I think Topps needs to start the living set back up again because I need a Basil card.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. No, after the series, I was like, man, it sure would stink to do cards of these characters.
Right. Yeah, man. So much to choose from too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you could do a Plagueis card. You could, I know.
Yeah.
You could do Yoda's bald head card.
Yeah.
You could do a back of Yoda.
You could do Pip. You could do little Pip.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So much.
But these are my latest ones I got off of eBay because these are ones I didn't have.
Mm-hmm. I can't see.
Oh, sorry, there's a glare.
Oh, is that Young Han, right?
Young Han, yeah.
Cool.
And then Chewie, which in this series, was this the first Jedi Wookiee we saw? Or have there been others that I've missed?
Gungi in Clone Wars. But as far as live action.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha. And then here's my first graded card that you did, Chris. You did all of these, right?
Yeah, the ones that you've shown, yes.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
I'm sorry of the glare.
Yeah, that was a unique one because they wanted me to do the Imperial Gunner, and I kept submitting sketches of what I wanted to do, and they were like, no, no. And eventually Lucasfilm contacted Topps and said, just tell them to do this. And they gave me the picture.
Of that?
Yeah, of that. I'm like, well, okay.
Well, and then I got the correct Maul, the big printout for Sam Witwer to sign in December.
Yeah.
And I'm very nervous.
Yeah. No, that's going to be fun. My son's looking forward to meeting him as well. That's going to be great.
Yep. I'm going to wear that helmet.
Hey.
And hopefully it's made out of Coruscant.
Cortosis.
I'm going to need that.
Yeah.
So I have no senses whatsoever.
Just to keep you calm, huh?
Right.
Yep. It'll keep me zen and focused.
Yeah.
Oh, that's funny. Also, what's his name? Manny's character.
Mm-hmm.
Chimer, there you go. His eyes went super black when he was in that state. Did Torben's do that as well?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. I can't remember if they did. But that, have we ever seen that before?
Mm-mm. Well.
Well, actually, yeah, kind of. That happened to Morgan Elsbeth whenever they gave the stripes on her face and like gave her all the super witch powers and stuff.
Yeah.
I forgot about that.
Her ascension, in a way.
Yeah. Yeah. Hmm. I forgot all about that.
This is why we have Chris on the podcast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Star Wars guru. Robbie is as well. You'll always be there.
I think Chris has got me beat. Definitely.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know.
Don't worry, guys. I'm far behind.
I don't even know the Chancellor of the Republic. I don't even know his name. Come on.
Dreadful.
Pathetic.
Yeah.
Don't dwell on it. No. Okay. So here's I was going to read this. This is about the creator of this series. Basically, this is a quote from her. I just thought it would be good to have the perspective of a person that had literally never seen Star Wars. So was the girl who wrote this or created it, she'd never seen Star Wars? Is that true?
No.
Okay.
No. From what I understand, like, they had No, she is like a big Star Wars nerd.
Okay.
And I think a lot of the deep dives are probably from her, like the things like that have existed in lore, but are very small things, like the Cortosis thing.
Cortosis, yeah.
Yeah, things like that. But no, she's a super fan, but I think that that's probably what their plan was in the writing room, is try to make it as like entry level as possible.
Yeah. Okay. That's what they were saying. So I guess they wanted people in the room that didn't know anything. So if they told a story, they'd be like, oh yeah, that sounds interesting. And yeah, not too nerdy.
Yeah. No, I think they had a writer or two in the writer's room where those people hadn't seen Star Wars before. They wanted like that perspective too.
Yeah. Because it didn't make any sense to me. I was like, the person who wrote this didn't know anything about Star Wars. It didn't make any sense.
Right. Yeah. Right. Right.
Good.
Yeah, I mean, to me, I feel like you can still write an entry-level story and know everything about Star Wars. Like, you're going 100 years in prior to any, you're totally disconnected from anything that the rest of the saga has told before. So I don't know why they don't just get people in there. There's no shortage of people that would love to write for Star Wars and are fans of Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes from the writers all the way to producers, to directors, to showrunners. Like, just get people in there that want to make these projects. And I don't know. This isn't maybe necessarily something, that would be because they have never seen Star Wars. So this could happen to anyone. But I just thought that the writing and maybe even the directing at times was maybe not what it needed to be, which goes back to that's where I was complaining that like stuff just felt rushed or hurried at times, and or the explanations of why characters did certain things. And that's what doesn't make sense to me, is they've worked on this series for a long time. Like, I feel like they had plenty of time to work on this, because we've known about this for at least 3 years, right? I think they announced it 3 years ago.
Maybe even longer,
yeah. Wow. So I don't know why it feels rushed when it seems like they had all the time in the world to like get it the way they wanted it to get it. Maybe
like they started working on it during COVID, and we clearly all had all the time in the world to do stuff.
yeah. I do think, and I don't know, maybe this did suffer from the COVID delays too, but I know, like, I feel like we did see like smaller scale Star Wars shows there for a while because they were filming stuff during the pandemic. Like, I know Obi-Wan kind of suffered from that, felt kind of small scale. Was it the latest season of Mandalorian maybe? I don't know. Maybe there's a little bit of that still going on there. I don't know, again, how long they've been working on this show. But yeah, I just wish that things would start to feel more cohesive as a whole.
Yeah.
And that goes back to like other shows too. Like, even Ahsoka had like just not the best explanations. And I know like there's always going to be additional seasons of shows, but I think they need to address seasons as like almost as like singular projects from one season to the next, and like tell a complete story. You can still set things up for the next season. But I just wish they'd get a little bit more focused on maybe completing these projects. I also think I'm rambling, but I also think that, we need to get movies back in theaters. I also just think they need to get movies back in theaters because, my goodness, we've had how many series now? And I just feel like I don't necessarily think it's fatigue, but it's like they need to have a big premiere event again back in theaters. It's been way too long. You have the most amazing IP to ever exist in your hands. You should have no problem putting out movies, and it's been, well, what, 2019? Was that the last?
Yeah.
20? Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just insane.
I think it's a Disney thing. It's the same thing with the MCU. Just roll this stuff out, but we need an anchor, like the Avengers. We need an anchor where this thing is good, and then let's feed off of that. But I feel like we're just throwing a bunch of stuff that you're right, they don't connect.
Right. And because how cool would it have been if you did turn Acolyte, if you made a movie called The Acolyte, and you could easily have cut that down into a movie. You could cut out a lot of the twin stuff. You could go in and that could have worked really well as a movie, I feel like. Mm-hmm. I'm glad we got it as a series. You know, I enjoyed watching it through. I'm never gonna not watch anything that's Star Wars. I feel like it's time to get the movies back in. And maybe that's why I'm becoming less patient, I think, with the shows that we are getting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I sometimes wonder when the movies finally do come back, that we'll all feel like, well, that was kind of short. Because we're so used to television and multiple hours of episodes. It's like, well, that was really condensed. And I don't know. Probably not.
Series on that to dive into it more. That's what they think. Yeah.
Right.
Because think about, we've had how many seasons of live action shows now before we even get a next movie? Like, we've had 3 seasons of Mando, Book of Boba Fett, Obi-Wan Kenobi. We'll have 2 seasons of Andor before a movie's out. We'll have the Skeleton Crew or Skeleton. And that's not even counting animation. So it's like, there's just so much. We'll probably watch the movie and be like,
we want more. What that means. More characters for trading cards, tops.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
There's even some right now that you could do, like from old stuff. Oh, everyone go to change.org and find our petition and sign it, please, for the Save the Star Wars Living Set. Do it now. Pause the episode and do it now.
Yep.
Anywho, I'm off my soapbox.
I appreciate it.
We appreciate it. I want more artwork.
Yeah, me too.
I've got an awesome Jaws one down in my cinema. And hey, are you doing anything else? What are you doing, Chris? Are you doing anything upcoming or what's
going on? Yeah, I've got, I'm still doing work for Tops. I've got several things coming. Some I'm not allowed to talk about.
Tell us. This is not like it's recorded or anything.
No, I've got, I just finished up a project for them, and I've got a project I'm about to start for their online card trader. They've hired me to make a movie poster.
Cool.
And I'm in the process of getting all that approved. And I'm still doing plenty of work for Tops. I'm negotiating stuff right now, but
that sounds fun.
I'll be able to talk about all this stuff hopefully starting next week. So
cool.
We should delay the episode. Let's just talk for a full week. We'll stay right here. We'll talk nothing but Star Wars for a full week, and then you can tell us.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So should we stay tuned to Tops or your page, or how should we?
Probably just my page. Yeah.
Cool.
Facebook page, people. Chris Penix. Is it called Chris Penix Art?
Yeah.
Yeah. I always see it. I just can't, I know what the picture looks like on Facebook.
Yes. Right. Cool. Yeah. I'll be looking forward to that then.
Yeah. And hopefully soon I'll be able to talk to Fanatics people. The business or the company that owns Tops is called Fanatics. And hopefully I'll be able to talk to them face to face soon.
Oh, okay.
And maybe I can, I don't know, encourage them to rethink living set stuff. I don't know.
You can give them my number and I will share my opinion freely.
I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Tell them, watch a Muggle with a Mic episode where we talk about it all the time. So yeah. All right. What else? Anything else we want to talk about? Oh, can we talk about the real quick before we end? Darth Plagueis.
Yes.
And how that's going to come into play.
Yeah.
Thoughts.
Right before the last episode premiered, I told my wife, I said, I want to see two things from this episode. I want to see Darth Plagueis and I want to see Yoda. And I said, I most likely will get neither. Maybe I'll get one if I'm lucky.
It's like Christmas for you.
Yeah.
You batted 1,000.
Yeah. So no.
So you saw Plagueis, did you think you were going to see Yoda, or you were like, there's no way I'm going to see Yoda?
No, I didn't know at that point. I didn't know. So
it's cool.
But I was so excited to see that. I was like, they did it. They freaking did it.
Yeah. No, that. Great. Yeah. So that was incredible to like see in Plagueis. I guess he was already technically canon, but like to have him in live action. Yeah. Yeah,
with that was creepy sign fingers.
Yeah.
Well, and we know eventually too, like eventually those people are getting white, like Chimera and the twins, they're going bye-bye eventually, because we know eventually it ends up Plagueis and Palpatine. Yeah. So
will they go bye-bye, or will they just be not as important?
I would hope if you're going to go there and introduce Plagueis that these people just get eradicated.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about a Dark Lord of the Sith. Like, I know Chimera is, you assume that Chimera is the current apprentice of Plagueis. I think that's probably a safe assumption.
Mm-hmm.
And then you see that Plagueis sees Chimera is maybe conspiring to take on the Sith Master, you know.
Yeah,
he's training an apprentice. So, I mean, you would think at some point that Chimera and Osha and even May, I don't know if May, the whole mind wipe thing, I'm a little iffy on what's going to happen there. But you would think that Chimera and Osha eventually will be eliminated.
Yeah. No, so.
Will May come into play somehow. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's definitely, they left it with enough questions. I think they can, hopefully they learn about some of the things from the first season, because they got some stuff right. They did. They definitely did. And then some things fell flat. But I think if they take all the good from the first season and take that into the second season, if we get it, I think that could be a very promising series, and maybe even a much darker. I wouldn't even say that season one of Acolyte was a very light toned show, but right. I would even go just full on dark tone and gritty and everything for season two.
Right.
If you're introducing Plagueis into the fold.
So. Yeah. Those are like Plagueis and Yoda, and you got those people that are kind of the important ones. It's what's good about this show is it takes so far. It happened so far in the past. You can just like go through so many Jedi deaths that don't affect anything in the future.
Right.
But no, it's like Plagueis, like Palpatine probably just goes through apprentices like toothpicks. This is what Palpatine did in the movies. Every movie he had a new apprentice.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, and that's one thing we didn't touch on is the Jedi believing the Sith are extinct for a millennia. They say that in either Phantom Menace. Yeah, in the Phantom Menace, they say the Sith have been extinct for a millennia. So they got to be careful, too, of like just always making sure that. And in this season, you know, we end with a Jedi cover-up, right? Like, they cover up, was it Vernestra that basically lied about, all the stuff that had happened. So you got to be careful with how you do it, but you could definitely take some Jedi have them maybe be hot on the trail of Plagueis, and then he could wipe them out. Or yeah, there's a lot you could do, but
That's good. That's
yeah.
I mean, to me, that's some exciting. I mean, you kind of know how it's going to play out. I mean, they're not going to find him or reveal him or anything, but that's right. Exciting to me because there's this one. I haven't read many Star Wars books, but there's one called I think it's called Labyrinth of Evil. It takes place right up to the point where Revenge of the Sith starts.
Yeah, that's one. And that's one.
They almost figure out who Palpatine is, but something stops it, and it's so frustrating but so exciting to see how he was almost caught.
Yeah.
That I think that would work well with Plagueis.
Even though you know the outcome, it's so exciting to see. Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
And one thing you could do too is not have corrupt buffoon Jedi in the second season. Like you could have people that are like, and even if it's the High Council, they're like, hopefully they're wise enough to sense that maybe Vernestra's something's fishy there, and you know, maybe she's not being, they can sense that she's not being honest. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's because I think that would be important to the show too. You don't want to get them too involved, like maybe you don't want to have Yoda be so close on the trail of Plagueis, but maybe other grandmasters of the time or whatever, more what's the chivalrous Jedi, I guess. Mm-hmm. More noble Jedi be on the trail and less corrupt ones. I think that would be more compelling too.
It doesn't seem like any of those exist at this
time. I know, that's the problem. We need to see that. Yeah.
Maybe
we need
to see that in
season two.
Who's that funny guy who comes up and always tells her who's there and stuff?
He drove me crazy. Him and Basil were my two most hated characters.
He was like out of the loop, didn't know what to do.
Yeah. He was just, his head was on another planet the entire season. Just, and the one thing that where I just almost lost it was where there, we have all these Jedi in the finale. I always forget because Osha and May have flip-flopped so many times. So one of them's at the tree, or they both meet at the tree, and then Chimera finds them.
Yeah.
He's like, if I can find you, the Jedi aren't far behind.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of just them using the Force to find the twins, they're just running around with this little gopher. And it's like, why are we not using the Force? Or like, that's just one of the things that.
I thought about that too, because I was like, why are they using a dog to track them rather than their senses with the Force? Yeah. Because Vanestra, when she gets down there, she can sense the crime and everything. So the Force works, but I'm wondering if the hyperspace disaster affected something. Is that the same planet? It's the same planet, right?
Yes.
That was all on Brindock, right? So
I'm wondering if maybe they're not able to track there for some reason.
Well, I always assumed when like Jedi are around the Sith Lord, their senses are just like all muddied and can't quite. So maybe it's not as reliable, but I don't.
He was doing the crime scene thing again, like hearing them and everything. And he was there.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Yeah. I don't know. Just some of the things, like I said, it has a lot of promise. And if we do get a season two, great. Like, I think now that Plagueis is like in the fold.
That's my sign language for Plagueis.
Yeah.
Creepy.
Yeah, he was very creepy. They did really good with his appearance.
I'm dying to see what like the full CGI model of him looks like.
Me too.
Just to get a better look. That.
I will say, guys, I was very proud of myself. So we clearly know I'm the least Star Wars knowledgeable person here. But as I was watching it, and you saw the silhouette with the fingers, first of all, I was creeped out. Then we turn around. Nothing's being said, nothing. And I talked to the invisible crowd in my room, and I went, is that Darth Plagueis? I was right. Because I looked up after that, and I was like, yes. I knew something.
Yeah. I just kept screaming, they did it. They did it.
Yeah, that was a big moment for sure.
Which could have been done in a movie.
True. Yeah.
Another funny thing at the end of it is like when they're looking for the Jedi in the final episode, they're looking for the twins. The twins are by the tree with Chimer, and the Jedi are, they stumble upon Basil or Basil.
Yeah.
And none of them said, "Hey, Basil, we left you on another planet. How did you get here?"
Yeah. Also, was Basil like a double agent? Like, what? He shuts down Saul's ship. Like, there's so many questions I have.
He was just spoofing May, right? And then he met the ship, and
he was very confusing to me. I'm glad it wasn't just me, because everything he did not make sense.
Yeah, it's like, every time you see him on the ship, he's doing something that's inexplicable. It's like, what is he doing?
thing he does is he messes with Pip, and then May comes and takes Pip and makes him red-eyed. What was going on with that? I mean,
yeah,
I don't know.
Did Basil do something to Pip, or did May do something to Pip?
Oh, geez. No, I think May did. I think Basil put Pip on the charging station, and then May reset him later.
Yeah.
I think it was Basil. I think we got to Basil.
Maybe Basil is Plagueis's master.
Plagueis's pet.
Yeah.
That's actually, it's been Darth Tenebris all along. We know
that's a good theory. Yeah.
You'd never expect that cute little face.
Right.
To be so evil.
Right.
Oh, well, this was a good discussion, guys. We are an hour and a half in, so, and my ears are starting to hurt. That's how I know we've been talking a long time, because my ears start to hurt.
Yep.
But yeah, no, thank you. I mean, I enjoyed the series. I do think I'll enjoy it more if I watch it again.
Yeah, I probably should watch it again. See how I feel. Especially now that you can binge it, because especially with this series, it stood out that it was just cut. Like, the episodes would end very oddly. Like, it's like, so when you're waiting a week, it has a different effect than if you can just hop right into the next episode.
Yeah, some of these Star Wars shows should just hit all at once. Mm-hmm. I think this one, Kenobi and Book of Boba Fett would have all benefited from it just being dumped all at once.
Yeah, I agree.
Because there were weeks where I went and I was like, oh crap, I forgot to watch Acolyte. But had it all come out, I would have watched it all at once.
Right.
And probably understood the story better.
Yeah.
Or even do it a Bridgerton style where you release the first half and then we ended with Kyriel. Am I saying it right?
Chimer.
I don't know. When we get the force push from Chimer, and then the second half is released later. I think that would have worked as well.
Yeah. That would have worked too.
Mm-hmm. There you go. So what's the next thing we should be looking out for with Star Wars? Jinx.
is it Skeleton Crew or Andor?
It's going to be Skeleton Crew.
And so is that this like holiday season? Is that what
It's between, last I heard, it's between Thanksgiving and Christmas.
Okay. That's kind of what I had heard too, but I feel like they've changed, like they flip-flopped that schedule a few times. But
that's going to be hard for me, guys, because at the end of November, Wicked is being released, and I need your guys' thoughts on Gladiator too.
I haven't seen the trailer yet, so I don't know.
A Gladiator?
No.
Chris!
I mean, I love the first movie.
It's one of my favorite, like, top three movies.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Yeah.
One or two, actually.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I love the first one.
No, it's a classic. Yeah, I think, is it still same director?
Ridley Scott.
Ridley Scott.
Okay. Is it the same director?
Mm-hmm.
because I love Ridley Scott.
Yeah, I do too. It'll be good. It'll be good. I don't know. Can it really ever live up to the hype of the first one? I mean, hopefully it'll have like it'll be close, but it probably can never surpass. But I hope it's
so really good. Robbie has known. He's been on one of the Star Wars episodes where I had Chris Evans on the cover as the sexiest man alive. So I have moved on to Paul Mescal.
Oh, okay.
And he's the main guy. He's going to be playing Lucius in this. And Lucius is the little boy from the first movie.
Yeah, okay.
Who idolized Maximus. Well, something happened. I thought he was going to choose to fight in the Colosseum. But what happens, I don't know what happened, but somehow he gets sold into slavery as well. And that's how he becomes a gladiator. But he's like royal blood, so I don't know what happened, but I need to find out.
Hmm. Interesting. Mm. Yeah, that'll be good. I'm excited for it.
Definitely. Excited is an understatement. I'm going to take a day off of work.
I need to go watch Deadpool and Wolverine, too.
I'm watching that right after the podcast today.
Oh, that's, I think I'm going tomorrow. So
okay,
I'm gonna see Twisters finally next week.
I want to see it too. Yeah,
and then I'll need to see Deadpool at another time.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, let us know how it goes.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah, Chris, do you have Letterboxd?
I'm sorry.
Letterboxd? Do you have Letterboxd?
Is that some kind of app?
Yeah, you rate some television shows, but mostly movies on it, and you can follow your friends and see how they rate things.
Oh, okay. No, I don't. I should look into that.
Yeah, it's Robbie, pretty fun. What's your handle, Robbie?
Oh boy, let me. US Robus robus_20.
There you go. And I'm at Shop Girl. NY152.
He'll definitely remember both of those.
Yeah.
It's mail.
Locked in. It's locked in.
I don't really even like to shop. All right. On that note, thank you guys for joining us for Star Wars.
Thanks for having us.
Yes, thank you.
All right. We'll see you later.
Yeah, all righty.